Welcome to the section of photosynthesis. In this section, we will be speaking about photorespiration, carbon 4, and CAM plants. So, students, in the last class, we studied about the light reaction and the Kelvin cycle. We also told that the Kelvin cycle is also called as C3 cycle because the first stable compound formed is the 3-carbon phosphoglycerate or phosphoglyceric acid. And in the end of the Kelvin cycle, what we get is the sugar molecule or the organic molecule or the glucose molecule, which is the most essential part of the plant, which serves as a food. And not only that, it imparts in the repair mechanism in the plant. So we saw that how the ribulose bisphosphate binds to the 6-carbon dioxide molecules, and then how it forms an intermediate, and finally we get this sugar molecule and how the cycle gets back again. So there the carbon dioxide was utilized to produce the sugar molecule. Now we shall see other parts of the plant, different types of plant, how they are going to fix their carbon. So, the first question we would like to ask is whether the C3 plants are efficient. Of course, the C3 plants are efficient because they are going to produce the ATP and NADPH. And also they are going to produce the sugar for the plants and oxygen for the animals. But always the C3 plants cannot be efficient, particularly depending on the environmental condition. When it is arid, when the climate condition is arid or in the desert, C3 plants cannot function as they are functioning. Here, you can see in this picture, we have an upper epidermis. In the middle layer, there is the mesophyll where all the photosynthesis is going to occur. And the lower layer of the epidermis, okay, we have a region called as the stomata. Now, let us come to the upper region. Okay, the upper region, that is the epidermis of the plant, produces a waxy coating called cuticle. Now, the benefit of this cuticle is that they help to prevent water loss from the leaves, help the leaf keep the moisture. But on the other side, the gases that we need for the photosynthesis, that is the carbon dioxide, cannot get in. Right, the carbon dioxide cannot get in. On the contrary, the oxygen that is produced as a byproduct of the light reaction will also not be able to get out of this waxy cuticle. So the only benefit is that it will see to that there is no excess water loss. So the solution what is present for the diffusion of our molecules, which is required for the photosynthesis, is the stomata. These opening on the undersides of the leaves can allow for the gaseous or the gaseous exchange between the carbon dioxide can diffuse in and the oxygen can diffuse out. At the same time, when the carbon dioxide is diffusing out, even the water molecules can diffuse out. So that's a bad thing, right? But anyhow, we are not losing a lot of water across the surface. But we will lose water out of these tomata, and that can become a problem in places or in conditions when the plant is growing under a very hot condition. So only that time the water loss through the stomata can be a red signaling. So this is the same picture wherein we can see that through the stomata, the oxygen can diffuse out simultaneously, even the water can diffuse out. It's not an issue when the water diffuses out of the stomata, which are the underneath of the leaves in the C3 plants. And at the same time, you can see the carbon dioxide diffusing in. So if the temperature is not too hot or not arid or in the desert condition, this works fine. So the stomata open to outside, the positivity of the stomata opening is it allows the exchange of gases, and the negative aspect is it allows the loss of water. But I also told you that the loss of water depends on what climatic condition these plants are growing. So when we speak about the efficiency of C3, of course, C3 plants are the one of the best ones because they are going to produce the ATP and NADPH. They lose their efficiency only when the climatic condition is very hot. Okay, in the process of carbon fixation, the Rubisco incorporates carbon dioxide into the organic molecule during the first stage of the Kelvin cycle. We saw that how that ribulose bisphosphate goes and binds to the carbon dioxide and forms the intermediate unstable compound, and finally it makes up the organic molecule, and this process is known as the Kelvin cycle. Rubisco is the most important to plant that it makes up more of the soluble protein in a typical leaf. But this Rubisco has an affinity for both carbon dioxide and oxygen. And whenever it uses oxygen, that entire phenomena wherein it uses oxygen is called as photorespiration. This leads to the loss of already fixed carbon dioxide. It leads to the waste of energy and decreases the sugar synthesis. So, friends, remember that photorespiration has negative aspects. That is, what is happening is it leads to the loss of already fixed carbon dioxide, and it leads to the waste of energy and decreases the sugar synthesis. So, photorespiration is problematic for plants. And this Rubisco, as I said, it doesn't necessarily just fix carbon dioxide. It can also react with oxygen. And actually, its name is ribulose bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase. That is the actual name, okay? It is ribulose bisphosphate carboxylase and oxygenase. That is the enzyme, which means that it can either react with carbon or it can react with oxygen. So when it acts as carboxylase, okay, we have glucose synthesis. That is what you saw in C3. When it acts as a carboxylase, means when it binds to the carbon dioxide, we have the glucose synthesis takes place. Now, whenever the temperature is high and oxygen concentration is high, you see here, when the temperature is high, the oxygen concentration is high, Rubisco behavior changes. It acts like an oxygenase instead of carboxylase. That means carboxylation means it is the addition of carbon dioxide. Oxygenase means it is the addition of oxygen. Oxygen will be taken in, and in the process some different compound will be formed. Like when you saw that when carboxylation happened, you got the 3-phosphoglycerate. But when oxygenation is happening, we will get a different compound, which we shall see it later on. And by the end of this, okay, in photorespiration, what happens is carbon dioxide will be released. In photorespiration, carbon dioxide is released. It is just the opposite of Kelvin cycle, your photorespiration is. So here actually the carbon dioxide is taken up, but here you see oxygen is taken up and it releases carbon dioxide. Whereas in your C3 plants, what happened? It took up carbon dioxide to synthesize sugar. At the same time, in the light reaction, we saw that it produced oxygen. So this carboxylation, the affinity of the Rubisco depends on two conditions. If the temperature is low and if the concentration of carbon dioxide is high, then it proceeds towards Kelvin cycle, forming sugar. On the other side, if the oxygen concentration is high, okay, and the temperature is also high, photorespiration occurs. That is, the carbon dioxide is released out and no Kelvin cycle happens. If there is no Kelvin cycle happening, there is no formation of the sugar or the glucose molecule. So photorespiration, here the oxygen is taken in and carbon dioxide is given out. This is similar to respiration, right? But it takes place due to, in the presence of light, hence the term photorespiration. So photorespiration, oxygen is taken in and carbon dioxide is given out, which is similar to respiration, but this process is occurring in the presence of light, hence it is called as photorespiration. So such plants are problematic because at the end they are not getting the molecule, the organic molecule which they want for their survival. Just look at this condition. Here you can see that in order to avoid this very high temperature, okay, and to see that the water loss is reduced, the stomata closes. See, the stomata closes at night under heat stress to reduce the water loss. When this happens, when such a situation happens, what happens is before the stomata could get closed, already the carbon dioxide and oxygen would be trapped inside the cells. Okay, they are usually going in and out, right? So all this molecule, your carbon dioxide and oxygens, are trapped. So If the carbon dioxide is present, what happens? Photosynthesis will occur. That is, Kelvin cycle is undergoing. Now, all the carbon dioxide will be used up for the process of Kelvin cycle to occur. A stage may appear wherein the carbon dioxide concentration inside the cell is less and oxygen level is more. What is the use of oxygen? Nothing. They have to just diffuse out. But unfortunately, they cannot diffuse out because the stomata is closed. So the oxygen levels increases in the leaf as the light reaction uses up carbon dioxide and produces oxygen. We know that light reaction is the where the oxygen is being produced because of the hydrolysis or the photolysis of the water molecules. The water molecule splits, an enzyme splits the water molecule, producing the proton and oxygen. We saw in chemiosmosis of the plant. So this process leads to photorespiration. Okay. In photorespiration, you can see that your ribulose biphosphate binds to oxygen instead of carbon dioxide, because oxygen is present abundantly than the carbon dioxide. If this occurs, the rate of photosynthesis drastically declines. So here the enzyme, as you saw in C3 cycle, the ribisco is the enzyme which catalyzes the reaction. The ribisco adds oxygen to ribulose bisphosphate instead of carbon dioxide. And this process is known as photorespiration. And two important points you have to remember, that is, your concentration of oxygen is more and the temperature is also high. Under this condition, photorespiration is happening. So whenever your C3 plants are in this temperate regions, this type of photorespiration can happen. So in photorespiration, what is the output? The output is nothing. There is no sugar, nor there is ATP. Okay. So it involves three organelles. That is the chloroplast, the peroxisome, and the mitochondria. Chloroplast, peroxisome, and mitochondria. So what does your ribisco do? Here the concentration in your chloroplast, oxygen is more. So the ribulose 1,5-bisphosphate combines with oxygen in the presence of the enzyme ribisco and forms 3-phosphoglycerate and 2-phosphoglycolate. This is a new compound. So how many carbons are present here? Only 2 carbons are present here. Whereas here, you saw 3 carbons were present. So that is why your Kelvin cycle was also called as C3 cycle. Whereas this photorespiration is also called as glycolate cycle, or it is also called as C2 cycle, because only 2 molecules of glycolate is being, carbon is being produced. So now what your plant does is, it sees to that it converts your 2-phosphoglycerate into 3-phosphoglycerate. And finally, somehow, it enters into the Kelvin cycle. Remember, students, only when it enters into the Kelvin cycle, the sugar or ATP or NADP, all that is produced. A question should not arise telling that, okay, now somehow 2-phosphoglycolate, it converted into 3-phosphoglycerate and then it is producing the sugar, the end product sugar. No, we are concerned here, that is because of Kelvin cycle. Here we are concerned only with photorespiration. I shall tell you in detail now. The same picture, I put it in this way. Look at this. The oxygen combines with ribulose bisphosphate in the presence of the enzyme ribosco, okay, which has affinity to oxygen. And hence it is ribosco oxygenase. It produces phosphoglycolate, which is a two-carbon compound, and a three-carbon compound, phosphoglyceric acid or phosphoglycerate. And this phosphoglycolate is then converted into glycolate with the removal of the phosphate group. The glycolate enters the peroxisome. The glycolate is then converted into glyoxylate by the enzyme oxidase. The glyoxylate, in the presence of hydrogen peroxide, gets converted into glycine, which is an amino acid. The glycine then enters into your mitochondria. Two molecules of glycines are formed. The two molecules of glycine are then converted into serine, which is also an amino acid. But here, what happens? The glycine loses an amino group to convert it into serine. At the same time, it loses the carbon dioxide, or it gives away the carbon dioxide. And this is released out. Okay, so this is what I told you. See, like given we expire carbon dioxide or exhale carbon dioxide, the same thing the plant is doing. It's exhaling carbon dioxide, it is inhaling oxygen. That is why it is called as photorespiration. Only thing is occurring in the light. Hope this is clear. Okay, so two molecule of glycine, it loses an amino group, it loses the carbon dioxide which are released outside and gets converted into serine. The serine enters into the peroxisome, wherein it gets converted into hydroxypyruvate. Okay, so the serine and glycine can undergo conversion with each other here, as it is shown in the presence of glutamate and alpha keto glutaric acid. The hydroxypyruvate, then it is converted into glycerate. The glycerate, which is present in the peroxisome, gets converted, enters into the chloroplast, wherein it gets converted into phosphoglycerate or phosphoglyceric acid. So this is a three carbon compounds. Okay, we started with a two carbon compound and then we are ending here with three carbon compound. And to this three carbon compound, what is added? A phosphate group gets added. So that is why the term phospho glycerate or phosphoglyceric acid. So finally, from my two carbon, I got three carbon through the three organelles, chloroplast, peroxisome, and mitochondria. So here the ATP is not generated, right? ATP is lost in the form of ADP, wherein the phosphorylation has occurred, wherein the ATP donates one of its phosphate group to the glycerate to form phosphoglycerate. Only this phosphoglycerate then can enter into the Kelvin cycle to continue the reaction or the C3 pathway. So This is the entire scheme of photorespiration. So whatever was formed here, your 2-phosphoglycerate, ultimately your plant is somehow converting them into 3-phosphoglycerate. After it gets converted into 3-phosphoglycerate, only then it can enter into the C3 pathway, that is the Kelvin cycle. Once it enters into the Kelvin cycle, it can produce the sugar molecule. Until unless you see this entire photorespiration is a waste reaction, because no sugar is produced, no ATP is produced, no NADPH is being produced. But there are certain articles which says that photorespiration is sometimes useful. How it is useful means they play a role in plant pathogen defense. That is, they are protecting the plant against the pathogen attack. And also photorespiration is also involved in nitrogen assimilation. So they are involved in the assimilation of nitrogen. So they accumulate the nitrogen and keep. They are involved in the, as I told you, in the defense of the pathogen. So these are the some of the research articles, okay, which have shown that how photorespiration can be useful, okay. Nitrogen assimilation, defense against the pathogen, that is another important function. And photorespiration can also overcome oxidative stress. Okay, certain stresses which are caused because of the oxygen, your reactive oxygen species. Okay. And another important function is it protects the cells against the damages caused by oxygen. It protects your cells. Okay, it protects the plant cell. Plant cell against oxygen damage. So these are the some of the important aspects of photorespiration, which is quoted in some papers. But if you see the overall reaction, nothing is much, what is much needed for the plant that is not being produced. So this is similarly that shows that how Kelvin cycle and comparison of your Kelvin cycle and photorespiration. We can see that now whatever we spoke about a salvage pathway, okay, wherein the 2-phosphoglycolate, how it went into your chloroplast, into your peroxisome, into your mitochondria, and finally get converted back to phosphoglycerate and continue your Kelvin cycle. That can also happen, okay, but ultimately what happens, you are losing the carbon dioxide. Net effect loss of 3 fixed carbon is lost. You are not fixing carbon here, you are losing the carbon, and no glucose is made, not enough carbon atoms to regenerate ribulose biphosphate. So the main important reaction of the plant is not that. That is why we call photorespiration is a wasteful reaction to the plant. Though I told some of the articles have told that they have do play a role in nitrogen assimilation, protection against the pathogen, protection against oxidative damages, protects the plant against the oxygen, any deleterious effect caused by the oxygen, it protects. So next, coming to our C4 plants, or it is also called as hat slack C4 cycle, named after the scientist. So C4 plant is an answer to photorespiration. So whenever if the temperature is too high, we told that the plant takes over the photorespiration method. But here you can see that C4 plant reduces photorespiration. So it occurs in the mesophyll cell, and the Kelvin cycle occurs in the bundle sheath. It is maintained at very high level, higher growth, do not waste ATP and NADPH. Some of the example are sugarcane, monocots, and few diacots. So first, before we go into the C4 pathway, we shall look into the differences between the anatomy of the C3 and C4. In a typical C3 leaf, what you're seeing here, we see there is a air spaces. Here there this near the air spaces are almost near the stomata, and the air, and we can see our mesophyll cells. Okay, we can see our air spaces, we can see our stomata, we can see our mesophyll cells, and these all cells have access to air and to the carbon dioxide and oxygen that may be here. But when we compare it with the C4 plant, we see the anatomy is completely changed. Okay, we see a very different anatomy, and the C4 plants, we have a mesophyll. Look at this. This is the mesophyll, a bundle sheath, the blue one, and surrounding this, mesophylls are surrounding a bundle sheath, and in the middle we have a vascular tissue that brings the water up to the leaf and take the sugars away. So this is the difference in the anatomy between the C3 and C4 plant, and this is the very important anatomy of the C4 plants, which is avoiding the photorespiration, which the C3 plants were unable to do. So C4 pathway uses a unique anatomical difference to ensure the optimal carbon dioxide fixation. Okay. So there is no question of photorespiration. So it is a solution to photorespiration. Who are C4 plants? Just because their anatomy are different. Here we saw the air spaces and the stomata are present beneath the mesophyll cell, and we have the access towards all the gases, that is your carbon dioxide or oxygen. Here you see your mesophyll cells wrap around. This is your mesophyll cells. Okay, these wrap around your bundle sheath, and within is the vascular cells, that is your xylem and phloem. And what is the important of your C4 plant is to avoid photorespiration. So in C4 pathway fixes carbon twice, first in the mesophyll cell here, okay, and then in the bundle sheath. C4 pathway keeps oxygen away from the ribulose bisphosphate, or other words, from the enzyme ribisco. We told that ribisco is a carboxylase and oxygenase. If the carbon dioxide concentration is more, it goes towards it. Or if the oxygen concentration is more than the carbon dioxide, it goes towards oxygen. That is what is ribisco carboxylase oxygenase enzyme's function is. But C4 plant keeps oxygen away from ribulose bisphosphate. And you can see some of the example, as I mentioned here, is corn and sugarcane. So the carbon dioxide is fixed in 4-carbon compound. Why it is called C4 plant means the first fixed compound. You saw in photorespiration, it is also called a C2 plant because the first compound which is fixed is the glycolate, or it is also known as glycolate cycle. Photorespiration, glycolate cycle, or C2 cycle. C4 plants, Hatch-Lack's pathway also it is called, or it is also called as C4 because immediately what should strike to your mind is a compound is formed which is having 4 carbon atoms. So what is its main functions? It's avoid entering the photorespiration. It gives no chance for photorespiration. So we have an enzyme called as phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase. So the compound here is phosphoenol pyruvate. So your phosphoenol pyruvate binds with carbon dioxide to form oxaloacetic acid, which is a 4-carbon compound. We shall see that in detail. So look at the C4 pathway. The carbon fixation in the mesophyll. Okay, this, please remember, this is the mesophyll outer. So the innermost is your vein. I mean the vascular tissues. Outside the vascular tissue is your bundle sheet. Outside the bundle sheet is your mesophyll cell, which are all wrapped. Okay. So we have here not Rubisco, but another compound which is termed as phenylenol pyruvate, or most commonly phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase, which will bind to carbon dioxide but not to oxygen. It will not bind to oxygen. So the PEP carboxylase will bind only to carbon dioxide. How much the oxygen is present? Okay, no matter. Even if I have less amount of carbon dioxide, I will only bind to carbon dioxide. Its PEP carboxylase has affinity only to carbon dioxide. When PEP binds with carbon dioxide, it forms oxaloacetate. So your PEP, already you know it is a 3-carbon compound. When it binds to the 1-carbon compound, carbon dioxide, it forms 4-carbon compound oxaloacetate, hence C4 pathway, the name. Both the pictures are same, only it is represented in the different form. Here you can see that this is the air space wherein you have the oxygen and carbon dioxide. So both can compete. Right, oxygen and carbon dioxide can compete. But what did we tell? We told the enzyme PEP carboxylase can bind only to carbon dioxide. Even if you oxygen, if you are there, I'm not bothered about you because I can't bind you. So the PEP binds to carbon dioxide and forms the oxaloacetate, which is a 4-carbon compound, which gets converted into malate. So remember, students, here the organelles involved are your mesophyll cell, bundle sheet, which is present inside the mesophyll, and the vascular bundle, which was the deep innermost. So vascular bundle function is to provide the water and the phloem. Okay, xylem and the phloems are present here. So malate is formed. Malate is also a 4-carbon compound produced in the mesophyll. Then they enter into the bundle sheet. When the malate enters into the bundle sheet, it is converted into pyruvate. Pyruvate is a 3-carbon compound. Then what happened to 1-carbon compound of malate? It is converted to carbon dioxide. Appreciate the beauty of it. Look at it. The 4-carbon malate gave away 3 carbons to form pyruvate and 1 carbon to form carbon dioxide, which can enter into your Kelvin cycle, which can produce the most wanted sugar molecule, and which can enter into your vascular bundles to distribute the organic molecules toward the to all the parts of the plant. Right? Again, this is the same Kelvin cycle which we are not going to explain. Okay, the Kelvin cycle will continue. So what will happen to your pyruvate? My pyruvate, which is present in the bundle sheath, then again it gets converted into phosphoenol pyruvate. Okay, so even this is a 3-carbon compound. So your actually, the energy is, it is an energy consuming reaction. So what has happened? The pyruvate, to this pyruvate molecule, a phosphate group can be added, and it be, there is a rearrangement of the molecules to form phosphoenol pyruvate. And then the cycle continues. So your ATP will be converted to ADP, whereas your pyruvate will get rearranged with the phosphate group to form phosphoenol pyruvate. This is the same picture. Okay, you can see your phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase. The enzyme catalyzes the reaction. It tells the PEP you need to bind only to carbon dioxide, and then it produces 4-carbon oxaloacetate followed by malate, which is also a 4-carbon compound, which enter into the bundle sheath, wherein it produces the pyruvate, and the pyruvate again gets converted into PEP. The ATP is reduced to ADP. The carbon dioxide, which is formed from the malate, enters into the Kelvin cycle to produce the sugar, which ultimately enters into your vascular tissue. So this is how your C4 cycle, even if the temperature is high, even if there is a competition between the oxygen and carbon dioxide, it can still be reliable sources for producing the organic molecule sugar, because of the enzyme phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase, which binds only to the carbon dioxide. Coming to the last topic is your crassulation acid metabolism. So these plants usually grow in dry environment. Some of the example I have given has the pineapple, orchid, or ferns. The plants grow in the dry environment, take in carbon dioxide at night, but do not fix it until daylight. Okay. First discovered in Crassulaceae family. This is the family. This form of photosynthesis is adaptation to both day and night and humidity. So these plants are unique because they have adapted themselves to the desert arid environment and both day and night. So it is an alternative carbon fixation pathway that evolved in plants that faces the arid condition, that is a very dry condition. These plants keep the stomata closed during the day to reduce the water loss. So during the day, it is very hot because of the heavy sunshine, and what will happen? There will be a water loss. So to avoid the water loss, they will close the stomata. So the stomata is closed during the day to reduce the water. All carbon dioxide is collected at the night. So the carbon dioxide is collected in the night. That means during night, what is happening? The stomata will open, right? Only if the stomata opens, your carbon dioxide can enter. So the night, your stomata opens and the carbon dioxide will all enter into the cells of the plant. If this is the cell, the carbon dioxide is entered into the cell when during the night. And it is fixed by phosphoenol pyruvate like in C4 plants, but then they are stored in the form of malic acid or malate. This is also a 4-carbon compound, but here that question of oxaloacetic acid doesn't occur. Directly it is stored in the form of malate. During the day, malate is converted, drops the carbon dioxide at ribulose bisphosphate to begin the Kelvin cycle. So night, what happened? All the carbon dioxide entered into your leaf, or I mean the chloroplast. So morning, what is happening? The duty is starting. What duty? The Kelvin cycle duty is starting. So Kelvin cycle starts and it produces the required sugar for the survival of the plant. So you can see here, at night, okay, the stomata opens. At night, stomata is open. So your atmospheric carbon dioxide is able to enter into the chloroplast, wherein it can combine with the phosphoenol pyruvate carboxylase enzyme to convert it into oxaloacetate. And in the presence of malic acid, it is converted into malate. So it is stored in the form of malate or malic acid in the vacuoles at low pH. So in the day, the stomata is closed. Now the carbon dioxide, nothing can enter because already the carbon dioxide are inside. The malate, which was there, this vacuole with low pH, now the malic acid just comes out, and then here the pH increases. So the malate, what it does is it gets converted into pyruvate. Okay. So your oxaloacetate is also a 4-carbon compound. Your malate is also a 4-carbon compound. So this is your 4-carbon compound. Then the malate is converted into pyruvate, which is a 3-carbon compound. So again, what happened to my one more carbon? My one more carbon has gone as carbon dioxide to continue the Kelvin cycle in the presence of the enzyme Rubisco. So there is no competition now. It can easily bind with the carbon dioxide and the Kelvin cycle can proceed. So Kelvin cycle can happen only in the presence of carbon dioxide. So Rubisco is your enzyme here. That is, Rubisco carboxylase should be present. Only then it can enter into the Kelvin cycle. And you, what does your Kelvin cycle produce? It produces your organic molecule, that is your carbohydrates. So also the pyruvates also enter into the, for the formation of the starch. So the C4 and C3 reactions are temporarily separated here. Okay, just because of their anatomical difference. Your C3 directly it is producing the Kelvin cycle. Your C4 is also directly producing the Kelvin cycle. Only thing, what is the molecules which are produced and the cells are different, right? That anatomy of your cell is different, but both of them ultimately produces the Kelvin cycle. I mean, they produce, form the pathway, the Kelvin cycle pathway, and produces the carbohydrates. So this is the three difference what you can see: C3 plant, C4, and the CAM plant. So this is the most simplest. Carbon dioxide produces the glucose in the mesophyll. In C4 plants, as you study now, you have the mesophyll, the bundle sheet, okay, the Kelvin cycle which produces glucose. Your CAM pathway, okay, again carbon dioxide. In the night, what happens? Carbon dioxide is all gets accumulated. In the day, they fix the carbon. So carbon dioxide fixation occurs in the day. So C3, C4 and CAM plants all involve carbon dioxide. Okay. So we saw that in your C4, the enzyme was PEP carboxylase. Only here all the three enter into the Kelvin cycle. The input is carbon dioxide and you're getting the glucose for your plant, except in photorespiration. You do not get any glucose, you do not get any ATP. In turn, the carbon dioxide is exhaled out.